Welcome to the Election Day special. Is it going to go blue or is it going to go red? Is the question, isn't it? But the bigger question is, how do we avoid leaving this world with a return ticket here? How can we find true joy? How can we find freedom? How can we find what we really want? Those are the real questions. Can any electoral result really give us what we really want? That's the bigger question. When people run for office, they're telling people, hey, everybody, I know how to fix the problems. I know how to, I can do it. I can fix it. Okay. But the truth is, and you can get this intuitively, even if it seems like subtly, because we've not been noticing it, we've been overlooking it. Problems of the world cannot be fixed. They cannot at all. Imagine someone ran for office who said, hey everybody, guess what? The problems of the world cannot be fixed, but we can choose something other than this world. Ultimately, we can choose something other than belief. We can choose something other than desire, something other than time, something other than impermanence, something other than threat, something other than invulnerability. We can choose an idea where none of that arises. And so, where it doesn't arise, where is there a need to fix it? There's no need to fix it. Intuitively, I can see the truth. But how to get it into the context here of this world is really a challenge. It's there. We just overlook it. We just overlook it. The truth is, we don't even need to see this world the way that we're perceiving it now. Because the way that we perceive it now, we're looking at something, the world, how to fix it. Okay, we're perceiving, okay, what can we do to fix it? To make it what we really want. But imagine if we realize it cannot be fixed. It's impossible. Okay. Then why would we need to see the world the way we're seeing it now? We wouldn't need to. We could see the world in a perfect way. And indeed, one of my teachers said that very thing when asked, how come you don't, what should we do to help fix the problems of the world? They asked, and under my mother, they said, what can we do to fix the problems of the world? And she said, but the world is already perfect. Just as it is. It's absolutely perfect. And they'd say, what are you talking about? You know, we've got all this hunger and sickness and economic and corruption and all this stuff. She says, that's the world. She says, what I see, it's absolutely perfect. So there's a different way of perceiving the world depending on whether you are trying to fix the problems or you realize the problems cannot be fixed. The cat is biting my leg because it wants to be fed. Get out of here, cat. Intuitively, this can be known, and yet it on the surface, we overlook this. We overlook this situation. So it's the job of those who can see this a little more clearly to speak up about it. And let others know that this is true. The problems of belief can never be solved. Belief is completely insane. How can you solve the problems of complete insanity, willful insanity, sanity that must be insane? Cat, go. I gave the cat some food earlier, and the cat would not eat it. And now it says, try me again. I said, you know, that's what happens in this world, is that, you know, you know, teaching is given, and we say, I don't like this teaching, walk away from it, it doesn't smell good. And then later we come back and say, I'm still hungry. The teaching is, it's not subtle, it's blatant. You know, I'm saying belief is completely insane from the very beginning. That's its nature. Insanity is its very nature. That's what it is. That's what it must be. And cannot be changed. It's impossible to change it. And yet we are so engaged in the effort to change it. Actually, belief is engaged in the effort to change itself. It's belief that's trying to change what it is. Because belief believes it can change what the Son of God is, make the Son of God the prime creator, which is we are the Son of God. We're the sonship of God. And belief is trying to change that. So belief believes it can change what it is, that the effects of a cause can be changed. The sonship is the effects of the prime creator, the Father, the prime creator. The sonship is the effects of that. And just as belief is the effects of the idea of wanting to change reality. Okay, so if belief could change itself, what it is, that would mean that the Son of God can change what it is too. It's an effect. If effects can change what they are and serve a different purpose, then there is no more reality, because reality is built on the foundation of cause and effect, of purpose and the experiencing of that purpose. So belief is frantically engaged in trying to change itself, and it insists that it can, and will always insist that it can. That's the big lie. Okay, that's what we have to see through. And of course, there's ceaseless change in existence. But that's what belief does, is it ceaselessly changes form, but it never changes its purpose, which is to deny that reality is unchangeable. That's always its purpose. So it doesn't change what it is. The more things change, the more they stay the same. So the more that all this change is happening, that's just belief saying, hey, look, you know, it's possible to change reality. Effects can change. The effects aren't changing what the purpose they're serving at all, because the purpose they're serving is the belief that effects can be changed. All this stuff is symbolic. See, belief is symbolic. There's nothing real being changed at all. It's just symbols that are being shuffled around. There's no life that's being changed. It's just symbolic life that's being shuffled around. Reality is being symbolized arbitrarily, capriciously, and then all those symbols are being shuffled and rearranged, and then it's being claimed that this proves that reality can be changed, that effects can be changed. It's a big nothing. It's a big zero. So we can see that all of this, that belief cannot change the purpose that it serves. Okay, so therefore, you know, we can't make it the way we want to make it. We can't make it reality, which is really what we want. We can't change the way belief functions. You see, it's a funny thing, because we think we are changing it. We believe we are changing it because we see all these changes. They say, okay, belief is changing. No, change is what belief is. That's what it is. So if we could stop all change, you know, no change in belief whatsoever, then that would be a real change. But we can't do that. We can't do that. Can we stop the planets from, you know, orbiting? The galaxies, solar systems from moving? Can we stop all motion in the universe? All motion of energy? Can it just completely stop and remain stopped forever, endlessly? What power is there to do that? There's no power to do that. Even God can't do that. God can't change reality. It's impossible. God is reality. God, so God cannot change what God is. Prime Creator cannot change what God is. So in choosing the idea of wanting to be Prime Creator, this gives rise to the desire, which gives rise to the belief that it's possible to change reality. And so there's all this change taking place in the universe, constant change, constant impermanence. What power is there to halt all this change and impermanence, but still keeping the idea of wanting to be Prime Creator with the desire and the belief? How is that possible? It is not possible. It is not possible. How could that possibly be done? We have to look at that. The idea of wanting to be Prime Creator necessitates the attempt to prove that change is possible, that it's possible to change reality. Therefore, you have to have all this change going on as a proof of it, as trying to establish the capacity, a power to change reality. If we had this idea of wanting to be Prime Creator necessitating reality to be changed, and there was an experience of no change whatsoever, You know, that would truly freak us out, and you know, it'd be impossible. But if it were possible, it would completely freak us out, because then we'd say, well, effects are not following the purpose, they're not serving the purpose that is given to them, and then that would, reality would seem to be non-functional at that point. And of course, it doesn't. That doesn't happen. The scenario of impermanence arises. Desire leads to scenario of impermanence, as Buddha pointed out. But where does desire come from? Desire comes from the idea that spirit chose of wanting to be prime creator, wanting to experience being prime creator. That gives rise to desire, which gives rise to this impermanence that is actually simply belief. And we're believing that all of this, you know, is some kind of real change, that change of purpose. So whether we elect this president or that president, we think that there's been some, you know, actual change, some real change. No. No, it's just more of the same change. It's more of the same impermanence. And if we keep the same president, okay, there's still constant change, and that will change after 4 more years anyway, too. So it's an illusion, a delusion, that we can halt the change or make the change that we want, because reality is perfectly stable, cannot be changed. The way that reality functions cannot be altered or changed in any way. So intuitively, we can get this. We can see it intuitively. But there's this gap that we're not able to bridge very easily here. It's been an extreme difficulty, extreme challenge, and many have come up short in their efforts and accepted some sort of compromise that, like, it's possible to have for a while, sort of an experience of no change, like a temporary nirvana or something. But it's temporary. You see, belief can generate a temporary truce, as it were, a cessation that seems as if, aha, I've got it. You know, that I'm, but it's temporary. It's not permanent. There's a big difference between those who can get into a meditative state of nirvana and temporarily be there. That is just still playing with belief. Belief is able to do that. But there's a big difference between that and those who have chosen a new idea and are abiding in unconditional love effortlessly, which doesn't change at all. Because there's no, it's the idea of not trying to change reality, meaning you accept everything as it is, reality as it is. There's no desire rising then. There's no generation of any change. It's a feeling of everything is exactly as it is. Everything's perfect as it is. There's a big difference between that and those who get into these temporary states of consciousness. Now, belief can manipulate consciousness to give all sorts of different experiences seem to be spiritual, like, yeah, this is what I really want. The problem is that it does change. Well, see, what happens is the rate of change gets slowed down. When they go into the pseudo-nirvana, pseudo-samadhi, those kind of conditions through meditation, is you can slow the rate of change down. It looks very slow. Temporarily, it slows down. But then it increases again. Okay, it increases again. You cannot maintain that state. And the change is still there. But it's relative to rapid change. So you get into this dualistic relative conditions where relative to super fast change, your state seems to be almost no change, you know, because it's so different. It seems like the polar opposite of rapid change. And then it's possible to interpret that as, I've reached no state of no change. But no, the change is still there. And it's just a temporary polarization, and then you start being pulled back towards the middle again, and you lose the state. So that is not the goal, really. That's not the goal that we're seeking. We're not seeking some meditative state. We're seeking what's called the vision of Christ, which is the vision of unconditional love, which is the vision of the overlay, a perfect overlay, where you literally see perfection. The whole world is completely perfect, just as it is. Moment by moment by moment, as it is absolutely perfect. reality is perfect. You know, it, and intuitively, we can see how that's possible. But from this intellectual standpoint, you know, it's just we struggle terribly with this notion. How can the world be perfect? Seen as perfect. But it's possible to advance towards this. It is possible to advance to this. I can see it intuitively, you know. Because everything is happening exactly as it has to happen within belief. And belief is serving the idea that gives rise to it. So that's perfect there. And our ability to choose a new idea is still perfectly intact. Everything's perfectly intact. Reality is perfectly intact. Everything's functioning exactly perfectly as it's supposed to function. And those who see it that way, they recognize that the goal is not to try and fix anything, to heal anything, etc., but to choose a new idea where belief doesn't even arise. And that idea, that ability to do that is perfectly intact as well. And that nothing that is happening in belief changes reality in the slightest bit. So reality still is perfect. There's some profound vision that is there for us, that is waiting for us, that we're just overlooking. And as we get wrapped up in voting for who's going to fix the problems of the world, we get our attention pulled away from this profound intuitive recognition. So it's important on this election day to reaffirm, you know, the real goal. And don't worry about spiritual states. Don't worry about any of that stuff. That's not the goal. Belief is very tricky. It can generate all sorts of pseudos, you know, spiritual states, all sorts of spirituality, all different types. It plays with relative, plays with duality, plays with polarization, plays with opposites. And it can give these pseudo states temporarily. Then what do you do when you come out of those, right? Oh my gosh, you know, then what you do, people spend their lifetime trying to get back to those states and never, you know, can maybe never do it. Because they're pseudo states. Whereas if you take the safe way, the real right spiritual effort is to choose a new idea, choose a new causal agent, which doesn't even give rise to belief at all. It gives rise to an overlay of belief. So belief is still there. It's overlaid, perfectly overlaid, flawlessly overlaid with that which is not trying to change what it is. It's not trying to change the purpose that it serves at all. It's completely at peace with the purpose that it serves. So your experience is one of perfect peace. And everything is perfect with that. And yes, all the belief is still perfectly serving its purpose too, okay? It's not separating from its purpose. That's why we look at, you know, belief, we're so conflicted. What's going on here? It seems so difficult to understand what's going on here. Well, belief is just dancing this dance of plausibility, which is why existence seems so bizarre, so weird. Because how do you try and accomplish the impossible? It's bound to get weird, right? It is bound to get weird. It has to be. It has to just spin off in all these different directions, right? Has to. Has to be just all this spin in every possible diverse way. You know, you just, and you look at it, and if you really look at the world, you say, my gosh, this place is completely weird. Completely weird. And yet, it's serving its purpose perfectly. Okay. You don't have to change anything about how it's serving its purpose. It's already perfectly serving its purpose. And we'll always do so. We'll always do so. You can't change it. Sure, you can heal this and heal that temporarily. Everything is temporary. Everything you do in belief is temporary. You can get into samadhi or nirvana. That's temporary within the context of belief. The true samadhi, the true nirvana, the true vision of Christ is to choose a new causal agent and be experiencing seamlessly that overlay, like Ramana Maharshi did. You know, you could see he was experiencing that. He called it the self, capital self, you know, which is the true, our true nature. In other words, he did not have the idea of trying to change what we are, what our true nature is, what reality is, and just abided in that acceptance of reality as it is. Acceptance of reality, the way reality functions, as it is. That is the goal. Not to try to attain some state within belief. So we may believe that we're not making any spiritual progress. That's come up many times, you know. Like I've never had a spiritual state, you know. Don't have spiritual states, spiritual experiences, no. In dreams I have sometimes some profound stuff, but as far as just day-to-day life, I've never had anything profound, never. During daytime, never, not anything profound. No spiritual states. And I think, wow, I'm getting nowhere. You know, what's wrong with me? It's because I'm bypassing all that stuff. All the manipulation of belief manipulating itself to come up with these pseudo-temporary states that we think are really pleasant and blissful, and we want to grab a hold of them. Somehow I realized intuitively that none of those were the answer that I was seeking at all. So why even waste time there? Because you can really waste time that way. That's the biggest, you know, huge time waster. Get into some, you know, pseudo blissful state. It takes a lot of effort, a lot of focus, a lot of concentration, and then try to hold it there for a while and say, oh, okay, I was able to feel kind of happy for a while or something. No, liberation, true liberation, is you enter an effortless condition. It's seamless. And that everything is seen as completely perfect. Everything is overlaid perfectly. The entire universe is overlaid with that which is not trying to change what it is. And you have this feeling of unconditional love. Everything is unconditionally overlaid equally. And then you get this profound abidance in acceptance of reality as it is. And then the great bliss of that. That is the goal. That is the goal. These other states or conditions can just be bypassed. It's a waste of time to get into them. Because when we lose them, we'll say, okay, what did I do to lose that? Now, how can I, you know, manipulate, figure out how can I get back to that? You know, we're thinking that, you know, there's some process, and you spend the rest of your life seeking for, you know, esoteric, magical processes to get back to those conditions, and doing all sorts of breathing exercises and trying to oxygenate this and that, and get the brain working some way, and you get into all of that. Waste of time. So the truth is, you may not be having any of these, you know, peak spiritual experiences in your life. That doesn't mean that you're not making great progress. It may mean you're making, you know, super progress. It's very possible. You know, a lot of times I judge myself saying, wow, I've not had any of these peak experiences, so maybe I have not gone anywhere. But on the other hand, I also get this intuitive feeling that I'm able to see, you know, the resolution to the entire situation. I'm very clear about it, and I say, maybe I'm actually almost on the brink of, you know, complete true liberation, which seems more likely. That seems more likely. But then the other hand, I go back, oh, wait a minute, I've not had any of these nirvana samadhi experiences or anything like that. I say, I'm not sure, you know, which is which, but probably I'm probably on the brink of true liberation. It would seem so, from being able to look at the world and say and realize I don't need to see the world this way anymore, and with no attachment to it, because I don't need to focus on fixing anything. I can drop the entire attempt to fix anything with this world. Now, pragmatically, of course, you live your life, you take care of what you need to take care of to live a life. But you're not investing or attached to any of that as far as fixing the overall dynamics of existence. You realize that you're not doing anything to fix the problems of existence, because there isn't really a problem, any problems. They're simply insanity. They're simply impossibility. They're simply futility. Spinning all these different ways to try and distract from the core fact that it's impossible, and therefore fixing it. There's no fix. There's simply you need to choose a different causal agent that doesn't give rise to futility and impossibility. That's the fix. It's not like you have to slow down the spin here and speed it up there, and you try to manipulate all the spin. That's a waste of time. So it's not that you don't live a pragmatic life. Absolutely, you live a pragmatic life. It's simply, as I say, you're not attached to any results. In other words, you're not hoping for a fix of the problems of the world. You're not hoping to, you know, cure cancer. You're not hoping to cure sickness. You're not hoping to cure death. You're not hoping to cure anything, you know. And if some cure comes up again, you know, that doesn't change, you know. It doesn't change futility or impossibility and all the spin of change that is supposedly the way to get past the impossible. You're not deluded to that anymore, but you can still function fine in this world. There's no attachment to any results. You're not deluded by what's going on. That's what those who have attained true liberation tell us. Okay, so you don't have to be holed up in a cave afraid that if we go out in the world we might try to fix anything, you know. Now, if something you know breaks, you know, you fix it so it works. If you want it to work, it's pragmatic that it works. Just pure pragmatism on that level. But that's as far as it goes. Not attached. You don't try to bring it any further than that into the actual causative level. You know. You realize these are just effects, and everything breaks in existence. Everything dies. Everything decays. Everything falls apart. Everything's impermanent. You can't change the impermanence of existence. You can't do anything about that. You cannot do anything about the impermanence of existence. Impossible. And so this is a very, we struggle with this, that we can't do anything about the impermanence of existence whatsoever. There's a part of us that keeps trying, or at least, but that's belief that is trying. It's belief, and belief will always believe it can change what it is. In other words, it can get rid of the impermanence of existence. Belief believes it can do that. Whatever we complain about, belief says, no, I can do that. Because belief believes it can change reality. And if belief can change reality, what can't it change, right? It can change itself, can change whatever, everything. So to believe, nothing's impossible. That's its motto, you know, nothing's impossible. If you can believe it, you can do it. So you can never convince belief that it can't do this. It's not that impossible. And somehow those who have been truly liberated have given up trying to convince belief of anything, you know. They realize it's a lost cause. So there's somehow they manage to let that go. And from the standpoint of belief, them, that they're not, you know, they're nothing. They're not world saviors. They can't really help anybody. Because one of the most helpful beings that's ever been on this planet, Anandamayi, has been basically completely forgotten by belief. Why? Because she was so extremely helpful. You know, but belief looks at her and says, she's not helping anything, because she didn't try to fix anything. She just says, no, everything's perfect. And belief says, that's not helpful. That's nothing. That's nothing. Nothing to see here. No help here. Let's move on, shall we? And so that's the problem. The more helpful you are in this world, the less, you know, belief registers, you know, anything. But there's no choice but to be that way. And gradually people, you know, some people see that and say, wait a minute, this is very helpful. Someone who's not trying to fix in the impermanence, who's seeing impermanence is the nature of existence. And the way to get rid of impermanence is to get rid of the causative, change the causative agent of existence, not the effects of existence. Don't work within effects, change the causative agent. And then impermanence doesn't even arise at all in the first place. So in other words, you don't fix impermanence. You choose to not have impermanence arise in the first place from choosing a different causative agent. That is the root of all teaching. Once we see this, then we will be liberated, truly liberated. Once we can accept this, get to the point we can accept it, we absolutely, boom, like that, will be truly liberated. No doubt about it. And then these various spiritual states will be, we have no interest in them at all. Because those are only ways to manipulate impermanence to make it seem temporarily pleasant to us. We're not trying to manipulate impermanence. Let impermanence be exactly what it is. But we can be free of it by choosing a different cause of agent, different idea. The idea of not trying to change reality, not trying to be prime creator, therefore not trying to change reality. Choose that idea. Different cause of agent. No arising of impermanence, no arising of trying to change what it is. trying to change anything, the way anything is. It doesn't do anything to belief, because when you set one idea down, you also set its effects down with it. They both go together. And belief says, no, belief says it's separate from its cause, so when you set the cause down, it'll still be there. Not true. That is not true. That's a lie. And that's what we struggle with. We think, well, sure, I can choose a new idea, but how do I get rid of belief, you know? And because belief tells us it's separate from its cause. And so when you set the cause down, belief will still remain, so we have to deal with belief on it as if it were its own cause, you know. That is not true. That's the big lie, that it'll still be there. It won't still be there. It will not still be there. It's like when you have a candle and you put out the flame, and the candle says, well, I still got a flame, you know, flame's still there, whatever. No, the potential for a flame is still there. I mean, but the candle's idea, and the flame is the effect of the idea. Now, if you set the idea down, I mean, you know, the flame goes out. No more effects of that idea. But potentially, the idea can still be activated. We can still choose it if we want. And then the flame will return, the effects will return. But the seeing correctly the idea of wanting to change reality doesn't have any real effects. So, you know, it's not like the idea is gone, you know, it's just that we realize, see, that this idea has no effects to it, no effects whatsoever. But if we want it to be true, then it will seem, belief will arise, and it will seem like it's having real effects, where it's just really having belief. So it's this core teaching is the one to pay attention to. As I pay attention to it, I can see more and more clearly the very, very real possibility of true liberation. And all these other states are just very unattractive, very unattractive. It's amazing how unattractive the world has become. I was trying to think about looking at the world and recognizing it's all very boring, very uninteresting, very unattractive. Very blasé. I thought today, what if I had $100 million, what would I do with it? And I was thinking for hours. I kept thinking one thing after the other and dismissing it, saying, no, don't want that. I couldn't come up with a single thing. I couldn't come up with anything I would do with $100 million. Nothing. I couldn't come up with it. I probably thought hundreds of different scenarios. Not a single one was really interesting. Because I realized, you know, it's all futile. It's all futile. You know, if you say, well, what if I was president, you know, think, you ask yourself that question, what could I do? And I can't come up with anything that I would, you know, legitimately do. You could come up with pragmatic stuff, but really, it's a waste of time to give people false hope. And you can't really force truth upon people. You cannot do that. It's impossible. You cannot force it on anyone. Because the fear is too great, you know. The fear, belief tells us that it can separate from cause. And so we kind of believe, we accept belief that belief is some kind of new superpower, greater than reality, and that we live under its domain now, in its realm, its kingdom. And that we better do what it says. We better believe in belief, or else we're going to be expelled into the kingdom, into annihilation, into utter darkness, etc. You know, belief is very intimidating in many, many ways. Its very nature is to intimidate spirit and say that spirit has to accept what its tenets are. And it threatens, it says, if you don't accept these tenets, you are going to be wiped out, you know. And so standing up to this bully of belief is very difficult. It's very frightening because you literally think that you're going to be annihilated and destroyed and attacked and all this stuff. And it's not, none of it's true, none of it's true. And yet belief can assert anything it wants to, right? There's no limits to what belief can assert, but there's limits to what belief can do. It can't do anything other than follow the list, you know, give promote the purpose, serve the purpose that gave rise to it, which is the belief that it can change what it is, that it can change reality, can change cause and effect, can change the direction of cause and effect, and make effect the cause of cause. It believes it can do this. So of course it's going to assert that it can do anything. It'll assert that it can annihilate you. It'll assert that you're completely incompetent. You'll never be competent. You're an eternal idiot. You know, can't function. You're non-functional. It will assert that. If it can't annihilate you, then it'll say, well, you're completely non-functional. You know, then if you can't do that, it'll say, well, you're completely stupid or you're completely worthless. Or, you know, it just keeps trying to bully you and you keep pushing back, you know, and it keeps using little weaker and weaker intimidations towards you. Because it believes it can do anything, and that you're denying its power by not accepting this. You're somehow just capriciously, whimsically denying its power, which is not true. It was the choice of trying to be prime creator that was the whimsical, capricious choice. So it's belief that is serving a whimsical, capricious idea. And us recognizing this is not whimsical or capricious at all. It's getting real again. It's the real recognition of how stupid this idea was in the first place, so that we can then choose another one. So that's wisdom. That's clarity. And of course, belief denies this. Say, no, that's not clarity. That's insanity. It will say that. It will believe that. You know, push this belief on you. Push this belief on you. And I'm sure those of you who've been on the path to liberation, you know what I'm talking about, that you get this push against you, you know, like say you're crazy, you're insane, you know, you're a lunatic, you're a nut, you know, you get this push on you, because belief is pushing that on you. It's belief that's insane, that's completely insane, because it's serving a completely insane idea. But, you know, it has to serve this idea, so it has to assert that, you know, that it isn't this way. And there, it knows something is insane, but it insists that it's not belief. So that which is opposed to belief, it insists it must be that which is opposed to belief, wants to change, wants to get rid of belief. It says, well, that's where the insanity has to be. It's just projection. It has to project. Belief has to project its own insanity, the fact that serving a completely whimsical, capricious idea, it has to project that onto reality and say, no, it's reality that's whimsical, capricious, and completely insane. Has to. It's automatic. Belief is automatic projection. It can never say that, yeah, everything it believes in is false and it's serving a false idea. But it can't do that. It's a servant. Mind is a servant of spirit. It's not the master. It has no capability to say, I don't want to serve this idea, the purpose of the idea. No. It willingly serves it. It willingly serves every idea. So it's willingly serving this idea. And the will to serve this idea comes out as projection upon reality, that it's sane, and anything that wants to change this and drop this idea must be insane. It has to do that. It willfully serves the idea. Of course, spirit has the will to change the idea, and then mind will willfully serve that changed idea. So this is something that spirit has to recognize, that mind will always willfully serve whatever idea it chooses. It's willfully serving an insane idea right now. So that's why we get this pushback. When we want to change idea, mind tells us we're crazy, you know, you're incompetent, completely incompetent, we'll always be incompetent. And it gives us all this lies and nonsense and just keeps doing it. And we say, wow, there's something that really believes in belief. Well, that's the will of mind is willfully serving the idea that gives rise to belief. See it that way, and it will smooth things out. So we're touching on what really needs to be touched on. Imagine if there was how many billion dollars was spent on this election. I don't know, over a billion, right? I mean, I don't know, it's crazy amount of money. Imagine if we spent that on a campaign to alert people to the truth of the situation we're in, the stickiness of it, and how to get unstuck, how to stand up to bully a belief, understanding that it's mind simply willfully serving the idea that gave rise to, which means reality is functioning perfectly well, and that belief will project insanity upon reality. Make all this stuff clear. How about a campaign, you know, using billions of dollars to campaign and explain this to people. You know, explain this to those, to spirits, those who are identifying with this whole scenario. That's what should be done. Imagine if everyone donated for that purpose. You know, how helpful that would be. How extremely helpful that would be. People are extremely willing to give money to those who say they know how to fix the problems of the world. And they're extremely unwilling to give it to those who know the problems of the world cannot be fixed. Problems of belief cannot be fixed. Problems of existence cannot be fixed. Remember, we're dwelling in existence. Remember, this world is in a solar system. It's in a galaxy. It's in a universe. You know, we're in, this whole scenario is in a universe. So it's not, you know, fixing the problems. We have to fix the problems of the entire universe. This world does not arise in a vacuum. It's part of the entire process of the universe. The whole process of the universe gives rise to everything on this planet. Everything. There's nothing that arises on this planet that isn't a universal, from a universal process that's taking place. So we'd have to fix the entire universal process. All of it. Okay, it's totally delusional. But just imagine, you know, the song Imagine, blah, 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 imagine there's no this and this. Now, miss the point. Imagine if there was a great campaign to explain you cannot fix this world. You cannot make it what you really want. It's impossible. And you can't choose a new causal agent. Imagine if everybody donated for that, you know, the way they donate for this election. The heavy hitters came out, you know, and said, okay, here's a super PAC for, here's 10 million here, you know. And you put it into advertisements, you know, bought time on television and explain stuff to people. Maybe some people would start saying, hey, maybe we can stand up to this bully of belief, you know? That'd be a great way to spend a couple $1 billion. Because I don't know how else you would want to spend it, really. I mean, if you want to talk about spending money, if I had, you know, $100 million, how would I spend it? I don't know if such a campaign would get anywhere. You know, probably wouldn't get any in the media at all, right? You'd have to create your own media. You'd have to have your own media network, really. You have to have your own network and, you know, publishing. But still, you wouldn't be able to have a broad-based, you know, all the newspapers cover it. Like they cover the election. Every newspaper covers it. Everyone's talking about it. You know, it's all over the whole world. How could you possibly get that done by trying to, you know, alert people to just the facts of the situation we're in? Just facts. That's supposedly what religions try to do, you know, and historically. They get distorted by belief, of course, and go into compromised situations. But originally, you know, like Buddha taught, originally taught the truth, you know, Buddha taught the truth. There's no doubt about it. Jesus taught the truth, no doubt about it. Now, there have been various teachers who taught the truth of how to be truly liberated. How to be truly liberated. They didn't say, you know, you got to go out and fix the world. No, 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 no. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. In other words, let belief, you know, those who want to engage with belief, let them, you know, believe in fixing the world. Let them try to fix the world. You are called out of that effort into a different type of effort. Choose a new causative agent. But as time goes on, in belief, it gets twisted more and more into trying to fix the problems of the world. And that becomes the emphasis. And then, you know, the true message is lost. It subsides into the background. That's what I've seen with Christianity. The true message has subsided more and more and more and more into the background. And I've observed this, you know, very keen on observing all this stuff. Why do these religions started by those who truly teach the truth about liberation, why do they deteriorate, you know, over time? And they most definitely do deteriorate. Absolutely do. Very badly. And of course, those adherents of that deterioration, they insist, oh no, we got it right, and you're trying to correct it? No, you're completely wrong, you're crazy, you're a heretic. Yeah. Again, no, you're mistaken, that kind of thing. So if you try to correct these religions, you know, oh, you run into, you know, a buzzsaw. So you're a iconoclastic heretic, you want to get rid of the stuff. No, we've got it right. It's so obvious that the emphasis has gotten completely shifted. You know, very much so. The idea is that you're saved by grace alone. That is the truth. Not by grace and works. Works are pragmatic. There's nothing wrong with works. But it should be no attachment to works whatsoever. It's completely pragmatic. But you're saved by the grace of God, meaning your capacity to choose a new idea. That's the only thing that saves you. You can work on trying to charity and fixing the world forever and still be completely deluded and enmeshed in belief. And have, again, you've not gotten anywhere. And all the problems will still be there for you. They will still just changing their garb, you know. The skeleton is still there. Just keeps changing, putting different clothes on. Doesn't get anywhere as far as liberation goes. There's nothing against pragmatic help, of course not. Compassion, nothing against that, but it has nothing to do with liberation at all. Nothing to do with it. And so what happens over time is the emphasis shifts from salvation is purely and only from choosing a new causative agent. That's it. There's no other way to believing that you can work your way, you can earn your way through good works, through compassion, through tithing, through supporting this religion, supporting that, building temples and whatever, you know, and so many different things that you can work your way to salvation. It's not true. And it's because the religions deteriorate because the belief is such a bully, is such an intimidator. And it's super difficult to see through this because, again, mind is willfully serving this idea, and mind will project on you that if you don't do what belief is telling you to do, that you are, you know, you're going to be annihilated, or you're completely non-functional forever, or completely incompetent, or please, you know, all these things are super intimidating. So it's like you have to, you know, you have to be a lifer, you know, in religion. You have to be a lifer. You cannot be a dilettante. And even the lifers don't necessarily get it. Not all of them get it. It has to be a career. You know, it has to be a life devotion. It has to be, you know, the life's purpose. Otherwise, you're going to spend efforts trying to distort and change the emphasis of the teaching. Which is why generally the religions start out, they start out with renunciates. You know, those who are lifers, 100%ers. And they don't accept, you know, lay people and those dilettantes, they don't accept them. Because they know that that's only going to distort it. You know, when the lay people who are not 100%ers, who are not lifers, they always see it as if it's some manipulation of belief. Is there some magical, clever way of manipulating belief, and that can be used to help them in their village, you know. Help us get better water to our village, better sanitation. Help us get better crops. Help us have more fruitful marriages. Help us, you know, get wealthier and happier and get rid of these illnesses and afflictions. Help us do all the stuff. It believes that there's a way that somehow those who are liberated have figured out a way to fix the problems of existence, which is not true at all. And they're not willing to examine this belief. They're only willing to be shrewd. You got to understand that people who succeed in this world, you know, in belief to survive, are very shrewd. Very, very shrewd. You have to be to eke out an existence, a living here in existence. You have to be extraordinarily shrewd. Even the insects are shrewd, you know, they really are. Even the ants are very shrewd. The cats are very shrewd, actually. Our cat is very shrewd. It knows who's in the house, who has left the house, what it can get away with when someone leaves the house, you know, who's its ally here and who's there. You know, it knows all this stuff. It knows the timing of stuff when we do certain things. Cats are very shrewd. So are dogs. Everything here is very shrewd, has their own shrewdness, really. Survivalist. And, there's some that, by the grace of God, somehow manage to get by here as they're pursuing liberation, who are not shrewd. You know, I'm not shrewd, very shrewd at all. And when it comes to that, I can, you know, if people say I'm stupid, well, if they mean I'm not shrewd, that is very true. I seem to be pretty naive, very naive in a lot of ways, as far as, you know, I just sort of, I don't see the shrewdness in other people. Very difficult to see it. So I'm easily manipulated by the shrewdness, you know. So the villagers, people of the town, people of the city, you know, they look at the one who's liberated in a very shrewd manner, and they say, okay, how can I get them to help me? How can I get them to help me get elected, you know? How can I use them to get elected, you know? How can I use them? And they're very shrewd about it. But that's a mistake, okay? Which is why oftentimes, you know, genuine movements from those who are liberated sort of have a separation between the lay people and the renunciates. And they try to not really interact so much, you see? Very separate thing. Church and state should be separate, really separate. It's when you get this mixture of church and state in a certain way, there's problems. Both deteriorate. Both the church deteriorates and the state deteriorates. Because when you have a strong, independent religious situation with a lot of renunciates who are dedicated lifers, and there's not much interaction with the lay people that are not, you know, there's something about that that keeps the state on its toes and minding its P's and Q's, really. It really is. Because it can't figure out, how do we manipulate this, you know? How do we do it? How do we do it? We're not sure. And they're kind of like afraid, you know? They feel threatened by the church, by the religious situation, because they can't figure out how to manipulate it. So they're kind of in awe of it. You know, and they respect it. They bow to it, because they're bowing. They're saying, you know, the potentate, the Maharaj bows to the, you know, to the guru, the great realized sage, because they're thinking, you know, I gotta find a way to get on the good side of the sage and find their magic. You know, so they're very solicitous. You know, and then the guru says, hey, you know, this is let things be the way they are. You know, and so you have a benevolent potentate. Benevolent state under those conditions. But when church and state get too mixed up, then the benevolence of the state vanishes, and the state becomes vicious, which is the problem we have in the U.S. and around the world right now, many places. The state no longer fears the church, and no longer in awe of it, no longer trying to curry its favor, really. And then the viciousness of the shrewdness, the intellectualism and the shrewdness of survival, you know, comes to the fore, and then you have survival of the fittest, you know. Then it becomes really terrible. Then the efforts to solve the problems of existence become draconian, and you get very, very nasty situations arise. Whereas if you have, again, liberated sages in society, and yet separate, very separate. They have their own retreats, their own ashrams, their own place. You know, it's very separate. And the state really cannot touch anything they do. They have their own laws. They take care of all their own judicial. Everything they take care of is like a separate kingdom within this world. The state is very intimidated by this and has to ask for favor, you know. Has to say, hey, you know, we want to do this. What do you think about this? Because they're thinking, I don't want to ruin my chances of getting a hold of that magic. So they're very solicitous, which is a good thing, because then the church, knowing the true religion coming from liberated sages, they know how to tell the potentate, look, rule with a soft hand, you know, don't try and fix all these problems. Let it be. Accept what is, you know, be pragmatic, but be a benevolent potentate, in other words. And the potentate will say, okay, because they say, hey, if I don't do that, I might miss out on these big riches I know I might get. You know, it's enlightened self-interest, you might say, but it comes into the fore under those circumstances. It doesn't liberate the potentate, you know. And in fact, sometimes the potentate in old age, they say, hey, these enlightened sages, they're better than me being a ruler, forget it. And they become a renunciate. What you do when you have in those certain circumstances, what will happen is the enlightened sages say to the potentate, look, this is how you should structure things. When people get older, let them be renunciates. Let the children be educated that it's being a renunciate is the highest calling in society. You know, so they let this culture serve the purpose of liberation, and the potentate will say, okay. If you just give me a happy rule, okay, I will go along with that. Enlightened self-interest, you get the benevolent potentate. You get a benevolent state from those conditions. Whereas right now, the statists have things completely backwards. They want to get rid, they want to completely integrate church and state and get rid of any, you know, influence that, that the church may have over the state in terms of the state needing to ask permission for anything. And the they want the state to be supreme, and they want religion to be in awe of the state, okay? They want the enlightened sages to come to the president and say, Mr. President or Mrs. President, what do you want me to do? You know, how can I serve you? They want it to be that way. You know, they're egomaniacs like in that way. And it's not held in check. I mean, the enlightened, the shrewd self-interest is not held in check. And then you get severe abuse. You get totalitarianism. You get fascism. You get extreme draconian systems that try to control everyone's life and try to make everyone do what the elite bureaucrats want them to do. And then you get a hatred of religion. And you get an attempt to stamp out religion. Anyone who professes anything like that, they feel it as a threat. Pfft, re-education camp, off with their heads, harvest their organs, that kind of thing. That's exactly what happens. It's a drastic problem. So, you know, you even have a situation now where, like, lay people are having a very strong voice in the affairs of the nunciate orders or the way the churches and the way the religion is supposed to be run. You know, in other words, they're saying, hey, you guys, you've been getting a free run all this time. You need to now serve our interests. You need to serve our charities. You need to help us, you know, provide for us materially and help us do what we want done, which is a complete distortion of the purpose of any true religion, religious expression, which is towards liberation, which is toward choosing a new causal agent, is not towards trying to fix the problems of existence. They say, look, problems of existence are going to arise in one form or the other no matter what. So don't keep fighting against them so vigorously. Accept your fate, accept your lot here, and focus on choosing a new causal agent which will completely liberate you from all suffering. Entirely, forever. You see, that's way better. It's like the one who's hungry saying, please can you catch me a fish? That's what the lay person will say, the statist will say, I want you to catch me some fish. You're a great fisherman, catch me some fish. And the enlightened sage, liberated sage, will say, no, 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 no. I'll teach you how to fish, okay? I'll teach you how to fish. While you're learning how to fish, I will give you some fish, I guess. But I'm not here to just catch fish for you and feed you, which is exactly what the state wants. The statists want the enlightened sages to be in service of the state and just catch fish and feed the flock continuously, you know. Do that instead of teaching everyone how to fish. Because the statists want everyone to be dependent upon the elite bureaucracy. They want them to be dependent on that. They don't want them to be liberated from it. So anyone who wants the world to be a quote-unquote better place has to support enlightened sages being here in the world, has to support renunciate orders arising around the enlightened sages, and has to support the separation of church and state, and has to support the predominance of the enlightened sages and the renunciate orders around them, and the type of position that they have being actually predominant, but a separation between church and state. So the state still is governing the affairs of the state, but has to go, you know, to the enlightened sages and the renunciate orders to get permission to say, hey, you know, balance these, is it, what do you think about this? And, you know, it's like giving them veto power kind of thing. Like we have the Supreme Court, you know, that kind of thing, which is able to, you know, rule on certain things, are they constitutional or not? Well, you know, the enlightened sages would be like a Supreme Court saying to the leaders, look, that's not in alignment with what you need. And the leaders would say, uh-oh, you know, if we're out of alignment, we're going to have problems in our country. Now, look, the people who are shrewd enough to rise to levels of political leadership and leading society, they don't want society to be messed up. And they don't want things to be restive. They don't want revolution. They don't want to be overthrown. They don't want their heads to roll. So they want things to go well, by and large. There might be some cynical leaders who want everything to go terrible so they can somehow fundamentally alter the very nature of a society, you know. But by and large, leaders want to, they enjoy the perks of their leadership. So they'd like things to be go run pretty smoothly. And so, you know, they see the enlightened sages and how smooth the grace they have, and they say, wow, there's some potent magic here, you know. How can I get some of this? And they want it. They want it. And yet we're at the crossroads now where basically that is, you know, is going to be thrown out entirely. There's a massive push to throw out this very important dynamic, checks and balances here, throw it out entirely, you know, as much as possible, which means it's the end of the cycle here. You cannot have a world that places no reverence, no submission whatsoever to enlightened sages and the renunciators, the sangha that surrounds that, is a world, a civilization, a society that is going to collapse and collapse rapidly and collapse drastically into dust. It will absolutely tear itself to pieces. And that's called the end of a cycle, the end of the world, so to speak. And we're at that time. We're at that time, and everything is happening exactly the way what you would expect if the end of a cycle is going to happen. It's all happening that way. Very few enlightened sages in the world right now. Very few, you know, renunciate orders that are truly separate from state, that truly have their that are self-contained, you know, that their own kingdom, as it should be. That run things according to their own rules and their own laws, and are not, you know, under the influence of the intellectuals. That's going away the way of the dodo bird, and when that ends up extinct, the world will collapse and very rapidly plunge into most severe chaos. As you get all these different intellectuals leading all these different armies and as such, each thinking that their way, if they compose their way upon the rest of the world, that's the right thing to do. And then everything, all problems will be solved, and they'll just go at it, you know, tear each other to pieces like wild dogs. And it looks like that's what's going to happen. But we need to keep in mind a better way. While we're still deluded, there's still a better way, okay, that benefits everyone, that gives those who are deluded opportunity at least to gravitate towards becoming, you know, lifers, 100%ers, giving 100% effort. I consider myself having given 100% effort my whole life, so I'm a lifer, 100%er. Never took a day off, and it's very possible, but it's difficult, you know, in this world now. Most people find it very difficult. Now they'll go on a retreat for a weekend or something, and you have these gurus who say that's all you need to do. Just go on a retreat and you'll get it. you can get a temporary manipulation of consciousness that way. Yeah, but it, relative to some other, you know, state that you're in of consciousness, relative difference and change, you know, but as far as choosing a different causative agent and seeing through the entire delusion of belief and getting, you know, you better consider that you need to be a lifer to do that. It used to be that way, you know, and people understood, you know, if you want to succeed, you got to go all in. And these days, the idea of going all in that way, it just seems, people just say, well, that's crazy, you know. I've got a life to live, you know. I mean, even for me, I couldn't do it exactly as far as, you know, going to a renunciate order. I could not do it. It just seems too out of step with modern world, you know. And it used to be in Ireland, you'd get so many vocations, you know, for the priesthood in Ireland. And now I heard one year there was like one vocation or none or something, you know. Maybe there's more this year, but they reached a point where I think there was like one in all of Ireland, only one person. That just shows you the unbelievable. If somebody had said that in the past, you know, 100 years ago, 200 years ago, there'd be only one vocation in all of Ireland, people would have said, you're absolutely nuts. You know, no way possible that could ever happen. And yet, you know, it has happened. which shows the great deterioration in the world that has taken place. And yet, people believe that things have gotten better, which is the extreme delusion. You know, they say pride comes before a fall. Well, extreme delusion comes before a fall. Intellectual pride comes before a fall. Intellect thinks it's making things better. So the intellect says right now, hey, things have never been better. We're finally getting rid of that, you know, the power of religion and church. What they don't realize is once that's gone, there is nothing to stop them from tearing each other to pieces. I was told a very sobering story today by someone. I won't indicate who it was. A friend of theirs, who generally is a very sober, respectable person, went out and they went to a nightclub or something, and someone drank way too much and mixed all sorts of different drinks and was drinking heavily of tequila. And they got home, and he crashed out on the sofa, and then suddenly he woke up, and he had a completely different look to him. His eyes were like completely demonic, and he began raving and screaming and said that he was going to drive home. He had to leave right now, this minute. He had to go, and he was just falling down drunk, you know. And this guy, he had to tackle him and fight him and restrain him, and it was a horrible ordeal. And he said this guy was a completely different person. He didn't even know who he was. He had never seen this person at all. And it was just utterly frightening and terrifying and traumatic. That somehow, you know, this drinking too much, mixing too much drinks, had brought out some kind of, you know, alter ego or something. The guy went crazy. And the day after, he was super embarrassed and said, I don't know what happened. You know, this is incredible. What happened? I'm just so embarrassed about it. Well, the same situation with the world right now. You drink too much of the intellect unchecked. The intellect unchecked is like drinking, you know, shots of tequila nonstop and mixing it up with a bunch of other stuff. And then things seem to be okay, and you seem to go into a lull, and then suddenly, boom, you go crazy. The world goes crazy. The intellect goes crazy. It thinks that it has to, it knows how to drive, it knows how to fix things. And of course, if that guy had driven, he would have ended up like in his neighbor's yard. He wouldn't even be able to drive the car out of the driveway. It would have just smashed over fences. Or if he got out on the road, he would have just plowed into other cars, you know. Mayhem on the roads, right? So when the intellect goes unchecked, you have mayhem in the world. Mayhem, because the intellect believes that it knows how to fix all the problems of existence. And he says, here we go. And here we go, nothing to stop me now, you know. No religion, no church, nothing to get in my way, you know. And then you get the madness. So the hell, it's really hell. You get anarchy, you get chaos, you get war, you get collapse of civilizations, and rapidly. Of course, every intellectual believes they know way better than the church, you know. They're sure of it, that if they were just in charge, you know, the first thing they do is get rid of all religion, all churches, everything, get rid of it all. Now, of course, what is left of religion here, having been undermined for so long, you know, it isn't very good at all. You know, that is true. But the general idea of church, of religion, separation of church and state and all of that, you know, they want to get rid of that. They want to say that fundamentally it's a bad idea from the very beginning, which is not true at all. I mean, Buddha from the very beginning was a great idea. You know, someone, a liberated sage, gathering a massive sangha of renunciates around him. That's a great idea. That's a super helpful thing, you know. So it's not a bad idea, if basically, you know, you don't throw out the bathwater, but don't throw out the baby. The intellectuals, they want to throw out the baby with the bathwater, which is insanity. It's the insanity of belief, and it will result in a collapse of civilization, the end of this world. The world will annihilate itself. Nothing to stop it. Just egomaniacs running wild. And my associate, the one that I know who had this friend who went crazy, you know, he was telling me about it. I said, hey, you know, it's really bad. And the intellect gets very aggressive when it doesn't have the check. You know, when there's nothing, no enlightened sages that they can look and say, wow, they have something that I want. How do I get it? When there's none of that, they're unchecked. you know. But as long as there's a light and sage and light and sangha, light and renunciate, and who have some kind of, you know, amazing grace, you know, the intellects look at that and they say, I know they've got some incredible power. I'm going to figure out how to get that, and I need to, like, kiss up to them to see if I can get it. Then that puts a check on the intellect. It puts a check on it. It really does. And the enlightened, you know, enlightened sage will say, hey, you know, stop doing all the scientific research and all this stuff, you know, because that's a bad path. Knowing where it goes, where it leads to, you know, which is the ability to create unbelievable mischief in the world. They'll say, forget about it. Yeah, you can do it, but it's not important, not necessary. If you want what I've got, forget about that. You know, if you want what I get, forget about all this stuff. Forget about lawyering up on everything. Forget about pornography. Forget about it, you know. Forget about all this, you know, videos making all this stuff. Forget about all this high technology, you know. That's not going to get you what you want, okay? And then the intellect says, oh, okay. What do I need to do, you know? And then, well, okay. You know, lighten up on society and let, you know, let there be renunciates and let there, you know, and the right advice is given to them. And they say, okay, the intellect is intrigued, it's checked, and shrewd self-interest says, okay, let me play along with this because maybe I can get the superpower that these sages seem to have, lightened sages. Put the check on the intellect, which is necessary. When we see intellect unchecked, we see this present world right now, and it hasn't yet gone crazy, it hasn't yet gone berserk, but it will soon. It will soon. The tools are all there. I mean, the tools to genetically manipulate anything are all there. You know, you got these people at their own research labs, unchecked by anything, you know, making hybrids already, of all sorts of clones and hybrids and doing stuff that, you know, unchecked, they're going to unleash stuff that is just unbelievable in the world. Nanotechnology is incredibly unfortunate stuff. So much if it's unchecked. And of course, those people, you know, you ask them about religion and they just like look at you like, what are you talking about? You know, are you crazy? You know, they have this hatred and dread of it, you know. And most of the sites on the internet, you know, listing on their menu bar their options to choose, you know, news, politics, business, shopping, leisure, blah, 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 games. 99% don't even list religion. You can look up on all your popular sites and portals and browsers, etc., etc. They don't even list religion at all. That just shows you that that's it. Their desire for intellect to be unchecked, and they're worshiping the intellect, and they don't even recognize it. A lot of people, high tech people, don't even recognize any such thing as religion. They think it's just like crass superstition, you know, which shows just how extremely deluded they are. It's the intellect that does that. It's belief that does that. Of course, belief eats enlightened sages because enlightened sages know that belief is nothing. It's insanity. It's serving a capricious idea, and they've chosen a new idea. So of course belief projects upon them. Say no, they're crazy. They're insane. Don't follow what they're doing, you know. But if the sages, you know, don't come to a world, then intellect is unchecked and it will destroy the world. I mean, we're manipulating the atmosphere. We're manipulating stuff. I mean, in past times there was all sorts of stuff, manipulation done using certain resonances and various things like, you know, Tesla technology and all this kind of stuff with crystals, etc., caused all sorts of incredible problems. Intellect unchecked destroys worlds, destroys. And, you know, I don't see how this election is. We'll see what happens. But it doesn't seem to be giving much hope, you know, that for checking the intellect. The intellect really has to be checked in its tracks. Ananamayama checked the intellect in its tracks, you know. She was brought in front when she was fairly young, completely unknown really, except to a few intellectuals in Dhaka and some super intellectual, you know, brought her in front of the Congress of Religion or something. But it was a bunch of heavyweight kind of intellectuals. Some are religious intellectuals. And some were more intellectuals, etc., scholars of all types and stuff. And they grilled her for hours and hours. And she just effortlessly, you know, responded to all their questions, and they were just completely stunned by it. And they just said, wow, this is unbelievable. And it checked them, you know, it checked them. She kept a lot of stuff in check there, because at the highest levels of scholarship and academic reputation, they knew about her, and they kept their intellect in check. They said, wow, whoever this is, they're way superior to us. They've got some kind of super intellect. And so they wanted to know, how can we get this super intellect? I mean, that's how they looked at it, you know, sort of. How come she has that super intellect and she just runs rings around us? Doesn't even know how to read or write and yet runs rings around us. So they said, hey, show us. Can you please show us the way to get this super intellect? And she'd, you know, give advice, say, well, you know, consider doing this and this, and gradually leading them towards, you know, renunciate life and being 100%ers. And it kept a lot of stuff in check. When those kind of sages leave the world, the intellect becomes unchecked. Becomes very unchecked. Because then the intellects look around and say, hey, you know, we're the great, there's no one greater than us. We're it. So the intellect says, we're it. That's it. So we need to use our power to make things better. And then that's when you get into trouble. We need to use atomic power, you know, and to generate all the stuff. And then, but those people over there, you know, they're not letting us expand. We need to expand our borders. We need to expand our great nation, our great race, our great whatever, you know, our great intellect needs to, you know, tell everybody else how to function. And then maybe we need to use this atomic stuff, power, to help bring this about or whatever. So it's a super, super dangerous situation we're in right now. Super dangerous. I think it's too late to check it, you know, which is why I think the prophecies of end of the world, end of the age, are true. They're true prophecies. It's not going to be checked. It's gone too far right now. Even if some perfect liberated sage came into the world, I doubt very much that they would be able to check it right now. The momentum is such that too many intellectuals now have this super arrogant attitude that any interest in religion, it shows an abominable weakness, and they would feel that they would lose all reputation and standing if they even gave any heed to it whatsoever. That it's nothing more than a crass, crude, superstitious, mythological nonsense, you know, all that stuff. So, and all intellect, the works of the intellect have got such grip of the world now. You know, it's gonna pull it down. Let's pull it down. You know, now, you know, hey, you know, it's still, you know, there's still that little glimmer of possibility, I guess, if there was just suddenly a whole bunch of liberated sages in the world. And, you know, who knows? Will that happen or not? I don't know. Seems pretty unlikely. Seems pretty unlikely. So, hope for the best, plan for the worst. And at least keeping in mind that, you know, it's very likely it will not happen. And that the end of the age will come. And plan for that. You know, plan for that. And that's what we're doing here. We're understanding that, you know, this election here is not going to change the overall situation of the world, really. It's too far gone. It's way too far gone. From what I understand, the end point came in on August 18th, 1999. And I did have an experience. It wasn't a peak experience, you know, of some kind of spiritual peak experience. It was an experience of realization that the intellect has gained, you know, control of this world, and it's irreversible. It's finished. I mean, from that point, it's irreversible. And I experienced that. And I also experienced another planet, another domain that was completely populated by people that worship the intellect. And the whole place was just full of gadgets, sensors and gadgets everywhere. It was bizarre. You know, it's like this world is got a long ways to go still before it gets there to the planet I experienced. It was like my consciousness, I was able to view this planet. I saw these beings that were somewhat human looking. They were completely obsessed with gadgets, with all the, you know, the tools and of the intellect, whatever the intellect could do to make things seem easier. Now, you know, here like in California, they're now doing this huge program to put sensors everywhere in cars and in streets, so that cars get this constant feedback about when it's safe to change lanes, what the traffic is like, you know, what's the weather's like, the road conditions. They just want to give us, you know, technologically, all this stuff, you know. But that's just, it goes on and on and on and on. I saw an entire civilization that was completely based on that. And I realized that those who lived there that had died, that their mentality, their persona, that the afterward survives the death of the body in the afterlife, they're choosing to come here to this planet and bring that focus to this planet. And many of the people who've incarnated on this planet more recently are from this tech world that I saw, and they've come here, and I saw that all this was crystal clear. And at that point I felt like my spirit almost died. I felt like I was going to physically die. I felt if I kept seeing this clearly, I was going to physically die, because it was such a shock and disappointment to me. I was so devastated by it. I had to pull away from it, because I felt that my heart was going to stop. I was going to die at that very moment. That was August 18th, 1990. I believe it was 99. Which, interestingly enough, was the day the Aztec calendar says that this is the end of the world. And they were actually accurate, because that was the end of the world. The world has already ended, so to speak. Because what we have now is a different world. The checks and balances of the old world were finally overcome, and I saw the barriers to this world being overrun, kind of like Woodstock when they had these fences all around Yasgur's farm, and people just crashed the fences and knocked them down, and everyone just came flooding in. You know, it's like that. You know, there used to be some checks and balances in this world, and the people coming here, incarnating on this planet, they say, we don't want any checks and balances. We want to live where the intellect is in charge and intellect rules, which will bring about the destruction of the civilization, and then the emergence at some point of another civilization or world center, which is tech based, you know, where they have all these geeks, you know, on gadgets, something like that. So, really, the world's already ended, and we are how far into it now? We're about, what was that? That was August 99, so we're like 13 years into it. And the intellect has had 13 years of untrammeled to do whatever it wants to do, and from this, you know, figure the last 13 years, what happened? The internet arose, right, and gained this ascendancy in the world. And now, you know, smartphones, the internet's all mobile now, and that's gained an ascendancy in the world. And, you know, you have this just obsession with all of that, all of the apps, and there's no awareness of the complete superiority of the enlightened sages. You know, there's no awareness that they have something that is completely superior to anything that technology can ever offer, to anything that existence can ever offer. What they have is just infinitely, immeasurably superior. There's no awareness of that. They say, well, you know, I've got, you know, 1,000 apps on my smartphone. I can add another 1,000. I just wait until I can add another 1,000. So I can calculate, you know, what, I don't know what, how many calories I've had this year or something. You know, everything will be all geeked out, you know, diets, driving, breathing, metabolism, your health, everyone will have apps, you know, you have sensors, and your smartphone will be able to, you know, do your tests like that, you know, and every day you'll get up and you'll test your body, it'll calibrate everything, you know. Ah, we're very close to all that kind of stuff. Your brain waves will be calibrated, you'll have apps to, you know, your smartphone will have all these sensors that will be able to calibrate your brain waves, your state of consciousness, all this kind of stuff, and everybody will be obsessed with this, and it'll give rise to, you know, spirituality, where everybody will say, well, I'm in theta state, you know, for 47.6% of the time, and then I'm this percentage, and I have graphs and everything, and there'll be people who meditating, trying to get into these states of consciousness, manipulating consciousness with all their smart technology and stuff like that. You know, total waste of time. That's just manipulating belief. It's not getting free of it at all. Yeah, all that stuff, we're right on the brink of that, actually, and people are just eager, you know, for that. And the intellect doesn't want any check on itself. No, you know, it just says it's unbridled now. It says it's the king and it's the queen, you know, it's the one that can solve the problems of existence. It just has to, you know, get up every morning and get a complete readout of its of the body, and you know, tweak it. You'll have like you'll have like machines with like vitamins or various substances, you know, that automatically will read your system, and then mix, like, you know, paint, when you go in for paint, you get a base, and then you get it tinted, and then, you know, the machine mixes all the different colors now, different drops, and it makes exactly the color you want. You'll have the whole situation set up where you'll calibrate, you know, for exactly the way you want your system to be running. We'll somehow produce the food, you know, the nutrients for that, you know, probably in some kind of drink, you know. I think all these smart drinks are going towards that, where you'll have the base of water, and then all these various electrolytes and nutrients and minerals will be put into that drink, and you'll drink that, you know. We're going toward that very fast right now. And the type of music you listen to, everything will be set up to try and give you the mood you want. You know, all this stuff. It's manipulating belief, manipulating consciousness. That's all it is. I mean, that's the way some of the extraterrestrials function already, and they're bringing that in. Like the Greys, they drink, you know, this nutrient drink, or they bathe in it, they absorb it through their skin, and they calibrate it all, very sophisticated technology to get, you know, some kind of optimal nutrition and stuff like that. All that kind of stuff is already being done in different places in the galaxy, in the universe, and that's going to happen here very soon, theoretically, if civilization isn't destroyed first, which it may very well take place. And of course they'll try to manipulate the weather too. Everything. Whole biosphere, you know. What else do they have to do? You know, not knowing what liberation truly is, what else do they have to do? If you don't know it, have no idea what liberation is, what else is there to do? I'm not blaming them, anyone. If you're unaware, if you're ignorant, what else is there to do except try to manipulate your environment? If you don't realize you can get free of your environment, then you're going to spend your time manipulating it. There is no other option. Or you can get into just being resigned, you know, but that doesn't last very long. Be a martyr, be resigned to your suffering. That doesn't last long. See, but you'll try to manipulate it. So if there isn't any awareness in the world that you can transcend the world completely, can transcend the universe completely, effortlessly, and something completely beyond the universe that is way, way better, what you want, much, much, what you really want, if that's not apparent in the, you know, here, if there's not enlightened sages in the world, then what else is the world going to do except try to manipulate its environment and its situation? Believe the body is real, all this kind of stuff. Of course they're going to do that. Of course. So I'm not judging anybody, You know, I'm just saying these are the facts. These are just stating the facts of the situation, and then stating how can we, you know, do better than that. But it all starts with the enlightened sage. It all starts with the enlightened sage. If there's no enlightened sage, nothing can start, really. Because the intellect will not respect or revere or bow down to anyone other than an enlightened sage. You know, they will not. They will not. It has no choice with enlightened sage. It has no choice. It cannot do anything other than realize that, hey, there's something here that is more powerful than my intellect. There's some super powerful intellect, is how they look at it. They feel it. They know it's there. There's nothing they can do about it. But with someone who's not an enlightened sage, like no matter how smart they are, the intellect will not bow down to them at all. No way. No way. So there's really nothing that can be done other than an enlightened sage comes into a situation. That's the start of something happening. Other than that, it's futile. You're just going to try and manipulate your environment. That's it. I mean, that includes manipulating your consciousness too. You know, you will. So, you know, there have been enlightened, liberated beings come into this world. A number of them. Right now, in this world, you know, are we getting that? Doesn't seem like it. And we may not get that. You know, it's very possible we might not get that. And you know, it has to start from there. And the problem is that these traditional religions have deteriorated to such an extent, the intellect no longer respects them. They say, this is no check on us. There's no power greater than us in these religions now. And then forget it, you know. They don't feel the presence, they don't feel it anymore. So they just, you know, no checks on them. No checks. They're unchecked. Unchecked. They have been since August 18th, 1999. It's been unchecked. And you can see the rapid progress of what the intellect has done since then. I mean, the whole human genome project, unraveling the human genome, all the genetic manipulation, the internet, all this stuff has happened since then. You know, it was in the works. They were going towards that. But once they got unchecked, it went really fast. Really, really fast. So you might say the old way, the old world died, then it's gone, it's dead. And the idea we can bring it back, not so. We're not going to, you know, no matter who gets elected, we're not going to bring it back. It's gone. It is gone. Now, can we start anew with an enlightened sage, etc.? It hasn't happened. You know, I'm skeptical that's going to happen in any extent. I don't know. If an enlightened sage came to this world, if their purpose really would be to check it, because it's really not they'd have to start anew almost, and there isn't time, you know. It takes time to build up that kind of obeisance and submission and respect from the intellect, to check the intellect. It takes time. It takes time for them to get the memo, you know, that there's someone bigger than them in the world. It takes a while, and we don't have the time anymore. The intellect's, you know, ready to pull the trigger. So if an enlightened sage did come to this world, they might have some other different purpose, which might be to take someone from this world to another place. That's possible. I don't know what exactly they would do, and maybe we'll find out. Maybe establish something on another world, another place, a place where it's, you know, the egoic intellect is not so, you know, developed in terms of being able to destroy a planet, destroy things, not so destructive yet. That's possible. A lot of possibilities. A lot of possibilities. Possible to go to a place, you know, a paradise realm, the paradise realm, the death-free realm, that is fifth dimension. That is very possible. Possible there might be some enclaves here in this world. That's possible. But the main thing is to get the big picture right now. Whatever happens, having the big picture, you're aligning yourself with liberation. Literally aligning yourself with liberation, because you're not getting fooled anymore. And you're seeing cosmically how the whole thing works. Because again, this world is not separate from the cosmos. What arises here in this world, it is arising from the cosmos. It's not like this planet Earth is giving rise to all this. Because what gave rise to planet Earth? The cosmos did. Everything in the cosmos is arise from the cosmos. So, understanding, how it works here is understanding how it works in the cosmos, the basics. Being liberated from it here is actually liberation from the entire universe, the universe of belief. There's an entire universe of belief, which is completely unreal. Has no real effects. Is working towards developing a real effect, but it hasn't developed it yet, and it never will. So this universe has never developed any real effect, and never will. Yet you can't stop belief from trying to do this. You cannot stop belief from trying to do what it's trying to do. It is impossible. In order to do that, you have to kill the mind. You can't kill the mind. I know some people talk about killing the mind. That's ridiculous. You can't kill the mind. The mind is real. Give the mind a different idea, and it'll serve that different other idea. And that's what you want. You can't kill the mind. Just choose a new idea. As spirit, choose a new idea, and mind willfully will serve that idea, present it to you. That's the remedy. So don't try to, change existence. Don't try to kill the mind, any of that stuff. That's belief talking that way, killing the mind. Belief says, yeah, you got to kill the mind. No. Kill the ego, kill it. No. Just choose a new idea. Let the mind is going to willfully serve whatever idea you give it. No way around that. You can't change that. You can't change it. You can't go to mind and say, mind, I don't like the effects of this idea I chose, so stop willfully serving it. Mind can't do that. That's impossible. Because the prime creator created mind to willfully serve whatever idea you choose. So mind won't do that. It'll pretend to do it. It'll give you a pretend nirvana, but it won't give real nirvana. Absolutely not. Real nirvana is to choose a new idea. That's the real thing. That's the real McCoy. All right, so just be practical, be pragmatic. Don't think you have to do something about that. Don't think you have to do something about your ego or the mind or anything in the world. However things work out, they work out. Don't worry about it. Do whatever, you see as an expedient to help you go towards liberation. Try to use every situation. Now, I love deadlines, okay? There's nothing wrong with being a doomer, a doomsdayer. It's very helpful because you work off of deadlines. And when you have deadlines, you tend to do vastly more work, and get way more progress towards true liberation than if you don't set any deadlines. And you think, everything will just be fine, no problems, no deadlines. And you never put yourself under pressure, feeling a challenge, like I've got to reach this goal by this deadline. So I saw the election coming. I understand the consequences and all this stuff, and of course, and it is a tipping point in certain ways, in many ways, not ultimately, but in pragmatic ways, there's a tipping point. So it's going to be very consequential, pragmatically, for sure. And there's many reasons to say that it is a very consequential day, November 6, 2012. So I said, by that day, when I reach that day, I'm going to have certain goals accomplished. I'm going to have certain good habits in place. And so I went and worked like crazy to reach these goals. And I had about 5 days ago, I had to drop 5 pounds to reach the goal. And I believe that I've done it. I think I've done it. I'm right there, I was able to squeak through, by almost starving myself. And I wanted to start good habits in all sorts of different ways. Getting up early, stretching, workout regimen, changing my diet, all a bunch of pragmatic stuff. I was able to do all of it because I was under the gun of this deadline. If there wasn't a deadline, there's no way would I have done these things. So I said, this is an important enough deadline that I really have to have turn my life around in certain pragmatic ways, which I've done. That the way that I'm moving and walking and everything today, I realize, wow, it's night and day. The flexibility I have now, it's just night and day. How light I feel in my feet is night and day. My alertness is night and day. My ability to, flexibility to move around is night and day. You know, the way I feel is way better. Everything is just, you know, way, way better than before. So in five weeks, I dropped 15 pounds in 5 weeks, 3 pounds a week, which is pretty darn good. Think about it. In 5 weeks, dropping 15 pounds is quite an accomplishment. So it's okay to be a doomsdayer. Actually, it really is. I've always set these certain dates. I realize certain dates are going to be very consequential. I knew the August 18th, 1999 was going to be very consequential. I was clued into that somehow, that the Aztec calendar, as far as the end of the world concerned, was the most accurate one. Mayan calendar 2012 signifies coming up in very soon. It signifies a certain tipping point where you start to see the collapse of civilization, as it were. It's kind of like someone dies, and let's say they're just allowed to lay there, and people say, are they dead? Oh, are they going to come back to life? They're not sure, you know. And they think, well, maybe, you know, they're just gone comatose, or maybe there's some chance they'll come back to life. And so they wait for a while. And then one day they look, and suddenly the corpse has suddenly turned color, starting to get all bloated. And all this stuff, boom, boom, starts happening real fast. And then the corpse just turns, you know, horrible discoloration, disfiguration, this rigor mortis, everything sets in. And then people realize, oh my gosh, they're really dead. They're really dead. Nothing we can do about it now. It's kind of like that. In August 18th, 1999, this world cycle, you know, this whole situation died. It was over with. It was finished. And yet we've kind of been looking at the corpse for the last 13 years, wondering, you know, can we revive it? Maybe we can revive it, you know. Or maybe, is it really dead? End of 2012, we're going to find out it really is dead. That's what the Mayans are pointing to. What they see as the end of the cycle is when the realization comes to the people of the world that it's dead. See, there's two different things. The Aztec calendar pointed out the officially when the intellect officially was able to throw off the become unchecked, which was officially the end of this, the old world officially died then. The Mayan calendar points out when the world will collectively realize that it's dead. Okay, it hasn't happened yet. The world, actually, this election, a lot of people still think we're going to be able to revive the corpse. The United States is going to be revived. Okay, a lot of people are hoping for that. By the time we get to the end of this year, 2012, I think what's going to happen is people are going to realize that you can't revive it. It's dead, you know. And that will be a whole different ballgame then. That's when, then, you know, what I experienced back in 1999 will start hitting people, and people will start, you know, I don't want to get into that now, but the cat is here again. Cat, come on. They'll realize, oh my gosh, we can't revive it. It really is dead, you know. And then that feeling of just like, wow, how can I, you know, continue on, you know, is there. And so by the end of this year, we really have to have something extremely substantial, okay? And so I'm setting this new date. Let's what do we want to call it? December 21st, we can call it that. That's a traditional, you know, Mayan calendar, and supposedly on that day, we can use that as the next date, deadline. We have to have something very substantial at that point, of certitude, some presence of very substantial certitude, that there's something completely beyond, you know, belief, beyond existence. Otherwise, the collective realization that civilization is dead is going to pull us down. It's going to pull us down at that point. So we have about 2 months. No, we don't. We have less than 2 months. We have, How many days? How many more days to the end of the... we have 56 days to the end of this year. Well, let's call it the end of this year, you know. We'll give ourselves a little bit of wiggle room. So the end of this day, we'll have 55 days, let's say. Starting from Election Day, we'll have 55 days to the end of this year, to the collective realization that the old world has died and we can't revive it. It's gone forever. 55 days to that time. So there's a new deadline, you see. So there's something to hang your hat on, you know. You have time. You have 55 days to really get it going, okay? And we'll start talking about that tomorrow, you know, election day. From this moment forward, we will start focusing on the next 55 days. And I'm sure we'll do a great job of it. How many weeks is that? 7 into 55 is 8. You know, it's about, what, 8? My math is kind of pretty weak right now. 7 times 7 is 49. And so 56 days is 8 times 7. I don't know. I haven't done my math, my multiplication tables in a long, long time. 8 times 5 is 40. And then so times 7, 40 and 16 is 56. So yeah, it's 56. So from right this point, we have 8 weeks, 55 days is a better way to look at it, but 8 weeks. What can we do in 8 weeks? You know, in 5 weeks, I've done a tremendous amount in my life, tremendous turnaround in 5 weeks. So certainly in 8 weeks, we can do something even better because we're really under the gun. Because by the end of this year, collectively, the world will realize, we can't fix the problems. I mean, we're dead. The old way, the old society is dead, and we can't bring it back, and we got no choice but to go into this complete manipulation of our environment, you know, unchecked intellect, you know, we realize it's going to tear us apart, we'll be torn apart. And that collective realization, if we're not aware that we can choose a new idea, if we're not sure of that, we don't have some certitude, it'll pull us down. It'll pull us down, literally. No doubt about it. So we have 55 days, and let's get after it. Totally get after it. All right, very great. And we'll see how this day, election 2012, ends. But you know what? For us, it's actually beginning. It's the first day of those 55 days, which is awesome. We have this opportunity ahead of us. A lot of people, you know, may not be clued into this. We literally have this great deadline, this great challenge. This 55-day marathon, you know, to the end of the year, to get after certitude. Okay? Wonderful. Very great. That's it for this video.